out rules and procedures for the next Congress. A pair of House Rules subcommittees heard yesterday from lawmakers about ways to improve the operations of the House for the 105th Congress, which begins in January. Congressman Porter Goss of Florida chairs this 2.5-hour hearing.
Likely the last in a series of joint subcommittee hearings that Chairman Porter Goss and I have held to examine specific congressional reform proposals as part of the Rules Committee's continuing study of rules and procedures in the House. The objectives of these hearings is to hear from any task force, working group, advisory group, or individual member of Congress, a Republican or Democrat, who may have a proposal or set of proposals to improve the legislative process. By the end of today's hearing, we will have covered just about everyone, and we've heard from many people. If not here, we've heard from them on the floor and in other fora. Let me just say that I'm pleased with both the content and the conduct that we've had so far in these hearings. We've heard some very good ideas, particularly, and I'll say it even though he's not here, Tony Bielenson's proposal to make a shift in the schedule for one-minute speeches. We've heard a great proposal from Rick White dealing with using technology to open up the process here. And there are numerous ideas. And in fact, virtually every witness has talked about the need to improve civility and a sense of bipartisanship in the institution. We've also received tremendous input from the questionnaire that we circulated to committee chairmen and ranking minority members. Today we'll hear about plans for a bipartisan retreat that I've heard about, and we'll get an update on the Corrections Day process and find out how it's working, and we'll discuss proposals for making the legislative schedule more family-friendly, which is something that was discussed at the beginning of this Congress. From here, the committee will take some time to digest everything that we've learned from these hearings and the other oversight activities undertaken by the Rules Committee and the two subcommittees, and we'll develop recommendations on rules changes that can be considered by the full House when we reconvene in January. As we continue this process, I want to continue working with minority members of this committee to ensure that their input and recommendations are fully considered. This has been an extraordinary 2 years for all of us on both sides of the aisle, and I think we've established a good track record for bipartisan change with the opening day reforms that had the support of both Democrats and Republicans, enactment of the Congressional Accountability Act, the unfunded mandates reform, the line item veto act, and establishing a Corrections Day process. Those are just a few of the proposals that we have implemented in the 104th Congress. And as is evident with what we're doing here, and we welcome Chairman Goss to the hearing, as is evidenced, we have made a commitment that we are going to continue this process of further reforms to make this institution more deliberative and accountable, and so that we can do our jobs more effectively. First, I would like to recognize Chairman Solomon before we go to our panel, and any other members of the Joint Subcommittee would like to be heard. Chairman Solomon.
Thank you, Chairman Dreyer. And let me first of all apologize to you and to Porter Goss and to some of our witnesses this morning. I'm going to have to leave in a few minutes to go to the Republican Congress to talk about a couple of measures that will be possibly coming up next week, coming before the Rules Committee, and also the schedule for the
no need to apologize
rest of the week. But having said that, I just want to thank you and Chairman Goss for conducting these joint subcommittee hearings on rules changes proposed for the 105th Congress, and that's what they are for. At least since I came to this committee back in 1987, the Rules Committee has never held such hearings on House rules reform proposals for the next Congress. It has usually been left up to the respective party caucuses without public input, or for that matter, even input from the members. In a public nature. I hope such public hearings will become a tradition that this committee will observe in the future, regardless of which party controls the House. This series of hearings have provided for a very healthy and a very constructive bipartisan airing of our institutional problems, concerns, and suggestions for improvements. And I know I'm especially struck and encouraged by the number of bipartisan task forces of the House members that have appeared before us publicly to testify on various reform proposals, like the panel that is about to testify in just a few minutes now. I think that speaks well for the House, and I think it certainly speaks to the genuine dedication that many members have to restoring civility, comity, and bipartisanship within this House, and to rebuilding public confidence and trust in Congress from without. And I think that's terribly, terribly important. This spirit of bipartisan cooperation is something that the American people see too little of and probably would see even less of if it were not for these hearings that were held today that I believe are going to bring about a great improvement in this body. It is my intention to review all the reform proposals laid before us during these hearings, and I certainly want to encourage all of the Rules Committee colleagues to do the same before we adjourn. I think, as you all know, we may have an earlier reorganization for the new Congress this fall than is usually the case, so it is important that we communicate any of the proposals for further rules changes to our respective leaderships at the earliest possible time. Keep in mind, we'll be gone from here in about 10 days or so, and you won't have a chance then to be back here until your caucuses meet. In conclusion, Mr. Chairman, we can continue in the next Congress to build on the monumental changes that we made in the last Congress on that very first day. There's a lot more that can be done that can make this body a better body and make us all proud to be members of this body. That's terribly important to me. It's terribly important to my children and grandchildren that we are held in esteem, but we have to earn it. And I think this is one way to go about it. So thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and congratulations to both of you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sullivan. Mr. Goss?
Mr. Chairman, thank you. I have no prepared statement, but I do want to also thank you very much for all the hard work which started this whole process and has gotten us through these four separate meetings. We've had a great deal of member interest. We've had a whole variety of issues that have come out of this, many of which have been commented on publicly, some of which have gotten rather intense interest, I understand, and that is good. That is the refreshing spirit that renews the energies and keeps us up to speed with the people of the country that we work for. And I think that this effort has not only been useful from that perspective, but has been going to be extremely helpful in coming forward with some specific packages of legislation for the 105th. And I hope we will get it off the ground early, some of the things we've talked about and are on the record of these hearings. And I suspect that looking at today's witness list and the subjects that will be some other additions to those early efforts in the 105th. Having said all that, I look forward to what the witnesses have to say today, and I will be in and out because I have one other problem that I have to deal with. But I would
like you only have one.
Well, some people are fortunate.
You need more, I'll loan you.
Thank you. I'm not looking for more. I would like to note, Mr. Chairman, that the Honorable Deborah Price, a member has of our distinguished committee, has asked that her record be accepted.
Will appear in the record.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple of words at the outset. First, to commend our Republican colleagues on this committee for pursuing these matters of reform. As I said last week, this, I think, is the proper committee, the proper venue for this sort of thing, and I hope very much that whoever is in charge next year, in all seriousness, does continue to pursue these matters. But you people deserve a lot of credit for finishing up some stuff which some Democrats were interested in the past but never were able to get our leadership to do. So we're glad that you're doing this. And I also want to join Mr. Chairman in welcoming our colleagues who will be testifying this morning. We look forward to hearing their proposals about improving the way the House of Representatives operates. I want to commend especially the first panel of witnesses who will be talking about the proposal for a bipartisan retreat for members of the 105th Congress. It's very encouraging to see growing support for efforts to create a less partisan and more civil and collegial atmosphere in the House. And in a sense, it seems remarkable that this is happening at a time in the election cycle when partisanship is normally at a fever pitch and, in fact, is back home here and there throughout the country. Although when you think about how extreme the partisan rancor and mistrust was during the earlier part of this Congress, perhaps it's not surprising that this move toward more civility has emerged. In any case, it's good to see it happen. I commend those of our colleagues who've been leaders in this movement, and look forward to their testimony as well as to the testimony of the members who are testifying a little bit later on this morning. Thanks, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bielan. So, Mr. Linder. Mr. Hall. Mr. McGinnis. Thank you very much. We're very pleased to welcome our first panel, and I'd like to call Mr. Skaggs, LaHood, Sawyer, and Houghton to come to the table here. And as I said earlier, you all have a fascinating idea and proposal, and I've been very privileged to have been able to play a small part in this. And I think that, interestingly enough, last night I ran into one of our former colleagues who said to me that when he was running for the Congress in 1982, he said to then Majority Whip Tom Foley, "Would you come in and campaign for me?" And he said, "No, I have a policy of not campaigning against sitting members." So he said that obviously it didn't happen then, but when he was running for re-election last year, there were about a dozen incumbent members who came in and campaigned. And I'm not advocating that we go back to the day of 1982 when no member will campaign in behalf of someone in their own party who may be challenging another member. But obviously the goal of trying to improve what Jerry Solomon likes to always talk about around here, the comity of this institution, is something that is necessary. And the goals that have been set forth by your efforts are very important. So I'd like to call on you all in whatever order you'd like to proceed.
Go ahead, David.
Well, let me make just a couple of comments, Mr. Chairman, and you're kind to have invited us to participate in what is a very worthwhile effort that the committee has underway. I think if we ask any of our colleagues, particularly in confidence, what their vision of a great House of Representatives might look like, it would be a little bit different than the one we now live in. It would certainly involve hearty and vigorous debate, but I think with a much greater ingredient of mutual respect and even, if I might suggest, affection for each other across the aisles, because it would be based on a greater appreciation of why each of us is here, our motives, our good faith, and crediting each other with worthy purposes in pursuit sometimes of common goals and sometimes conflicting ones, but still in the national interest. I hear at home so often a complaint about this place, which boils down to, why are you all so prone to bickering about things? Anyway, I think the four of us who are now joined by four others at the direction of the Speaker and the Democratic leader to fashion a plan for a bipartisan retreat early in the next Congress, take both our own sense of a vision of a better Congress and the feelings we get from our people at home about a Congress that they would feel better about very seriously. We are in the early stages of putting together a plan, and I think my colleagues here at the table will address their own ideas about this and perhaps some of the details that we have tentatively worked out. I just want to say, as I look forward to the next Congress, and I don't want to be presumptuous about assuming I'll be here, we all have to get through the hurdle of Election Day in November, but as I look forward to that, it is clear to me that the most difficult issues facing this country are not susceptible of resolution by either the Democrats or the Republicans acting by themselves. The entitlements issue in particular, which holds so much else hostage, is only going to be solved on a bipartisan basis. We're only going to have the prerequisites to that kind of a bipartisan solution if we invest some time and energy in making this place more internally respectful and creating a better working environment for the House. That's what this bipartisan retreat idea is all about. I expect we will have good participation, and it will make a difference. No one can tell right now how much of a difference in the beginning of the next Congress. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Mr. Dreyer, and to the committee. Thanks for allowing us to be here. Let me just tell you two things that I have been struck by almost from the first day that I was elected. The first thing is the idea that we have an orientation for freshmen, and we had it for Republicans, and there were 73 of us, and there was no opportunity for the 73 Republicans to meet the 13 Democrats that were elected with us. And I think that may be the first time in the history of the Congress that there was not an opportunity for all freshmen to come together and meet one another. And I had no idea who the 13 Democrats were that were elected with me. We spent no time together. And I think that really did not get us off on the best foot as a class, if you will. The other thing that has struck me and something that I have used as an example is one morning when I was boarding a plane in my hometown of Peoria, and the woman who was taking my ticket from Trans World Express said, "Congressman, go out there and get something done for the people. Stop the bickering, the backbiting. You people need to work together." Now, this is a woman who lives in a Midwestern town. She probably watches C-SPAN from time to time. But she knows that the Congress really has to work together in a bipartisan fashion in order to get things done for the people. And of course, for me, the model of bipartisanship around here, the model for comedy, the model for civility, is my mentor and the one who I worked for 12 years, Bob Michael, who set a very, very high standard when he was Republican leader. He actually worked with three different speakers, Speaker O'Neill, Speaker Wright, and Speaker Foley, three different types of personalities, and was able to get along with them in a fashion that I think set an example for partisanship when it was needed, particularly on issues, but bipartisanship when it was needed to get things done. And I think in some sense that is what we are trying to achieve. I think we all recognize that there are going to be philosophical differences, there are going to be political differences, and there are going to be partisan differences. But they do not have to reach a level where they end up in personality differences to the extent that people have words taken down. I've had the privilege of sitting in the chair on a number of occasions during this last year and a half, and I must tell you, you are struck by the kind of acrimony and partisanship that exists over issues that really does not have to exist, I think. There are differences. And those can be exhibited, but they can be exhibited in a way that I think can mete out what the differences are in a fashion that I think serves the American people in trying to solve problems. I look at many of us who are elected, and the motivation is not dissimilar. We all come here with the idea that we want to get things done on behalf of the people that sent us here. And in a sense, I think if we can work together in a way that allows us to do that, then we achieve what the American people have sent us here to do. There are structures within this institution that I think have allowed some of that to happen. And I think of this morning, some of us got together as we do on Thursday morning for the weekly prayer breakfast. It's very bipartisan. Democrats and Republicans come together, we meet, we have breakfast, we listen to one of our colleagues speak, and we pray together. And we develop a rapport with one another that I think has enabled some of us to have a greater appreciation for the trials and tribulations that all of us have to go through. I think that is a part of this institution that we can learn a lesson from. There's also a Bible study group that meets on Thursdays. Again, a very bipartisan group. Those, I think, are opportunities that we can learn lessons from about how we can be civil, there can be comedy, and we can still have our differences around issues. When David Skaggs approached me with the idea of some sort of a meeting, a retreat, whatever, however you want to characterize it, I didn't doubt it for 1 minute that we could do it. And I must tell you that I am struck by the kind of support that we've had from the Speaker and the Democrat leader. They have embraced this idea wholeheartedly and said we will do whatever we can to lend support to it. So I think we do have good support for it. I don't know if any of you attended the family picnic, but I think that was a good start. And I think many of us were struck by the fact that at the family picnic we observed the Speaker and the Democrat leader conversing with one another, talking with one another in a very informal way. And I think that's what we're trying to create, an evolution here where you create opportunities for people to get to know one another better, knowing we're going to have differences, but that we ought to be able to exhibit those differences in a civil way and yet do the work of the people.
based on the way you've explained it so far, to maintain bipartisanship, we should just keep praying together.
Not a bad idea.
Yeah. Mr. Sawyer.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I, like my colleagues, want to thank you and your colleagues on this committee for your effort to undertake this. I think some of the ideas that have come forward in this setting have enormous promise. None of them are going to resolve the kinds of differences and conflicts that have provided motivation for many of the suggestions, but together they have the opportunity to improve and elevate the quality of discourse in this place. I think each of us brings a reflection of the diversity that makes up this country, this enormously complex mosaic that is the United States to this place. It's understandable when you recognize that there's going to be conflict here. There are going to be differences. But at the same time, we need to understand the terms and conditions under which we bring those points of view. I'm struck when I look around at the quality of the people who are here from each of their lines of endeavor, whether it be in business or in government, military, as the kind of staff work that has made this place great. Just looking around this room, we see the enormous differences. But the one thing that strikes me is that virtually every case, people bring a quality and commitment, a sense of excellence to the things that they did in their previous lives, to the work that they do here. Understanding that may be the single most important element in gaining appreciation for those differences, in valuing those differences. I, for a time in my life, was a teacher, and the business of teaching has never really left me. And so when I get introduced as a former teacher, I think to myself, you know, if I ever really was a teacher, I probably always will be a teacher. When I look at the physicians who are here, they're doctors, they're mechanics, they're analysts of the human physical condition, but at their heart, they're healers. And if they were ever healers, they're probably always going to be healers. We come here out of context of community, enterprise, family, education, faith, and understanding one another in those complex terms may be the greatest gift we can give to one another in trying to come together in common purpose, sometimes within the context of difference, to reach resolution. We talk a lot about common ground. Sometimes we don't stand on common ground, but ultimately we have to reach resolution. Understanding where we are all coming from is maybe what we have lacked. Ray talked briefly about how the recent Congress came and bonded with one another, the new members, in a partisan separation. I don't think that's new to this last Congress. I think that has been growing over a number of Congresses. And as a result, it may well be that between 50% and 60% of us who are here today have never had the kind of coming together experience that we would like to try to recreate through this project. It won't solve all our problems, but it may, in understanding who one another are, be able to restore a measure of decency in discourse and civility in indifference that can make for resolution. If not always reconciliation.
Thank you, Tom. Amo Houghton from New York.
Yeah, thanks very much. Well, first of all, thank you for letting us be here. And I also want to give great credit to this guy here because it was his idea, Dave Skaggs. And he and Ray are going to be heading up this group. There are about eight of us. We're trying to, as you know, go away as a Congress with spouses, with children, sometime after the turn of the year. It's not going to solve, as Tom said, all our problems, but it's a step in the right direction. As a matter of fact, it's sort of sad that we have to come to this and make a big deal out of it because it ought to be happening all the time. But, you know, democracy switches back and forth and we have to put this thing right periodically. The important thing, I think, is that both leaders are very enthusiastic about that. That is important. It gives the signal to the rest of the people that we really do want to concentrate on the issues of the country. Now, I come from the world of competition. The competition is great. We have competition here, and we have this unique two-party system, and it doesn't take the edge off a lot of things. But there's a way of handling competition, which is good. And the important thing, I think, here is, in the words of the great business philosopher Peter Drucker, all great ideas ultimately degenerate into work. And so this is the working group, and I'm honored to be part of it. Thank you.
There are a number of questions that come to mind, and one of the things that this institution has a pattern of doing, or those of us who are in elective office do, is bash the media, and I'm not going to do that, but I would raise one question about that, and that is, many in the media, as they look at this institution, rather than focusing on issues, often focus on personalities. And at the organizational meeting that we held yesterday, one of the things that came up is that frankly, an overwhelming majority of Republicans and Democrats in this institution do want to work together, but there are probably a few on either side who may have a tendency to exacerbate some of the problems that we have. And I wondered if as we look at that and the tension that's focused sometimes on those individuals, if you all have any thoughts as to how we could address that concern. Yeah, Tony says end to 1 minute. We went through that at our hearing last week.
Anybody that has the answer to that deserves the Nobel Peace Prize, I think, Mr. Chairman. But
we're hoping to.
It seems to me that what we're really talking about here is changing a culture, and creating a different sense within the membership of the House of Representatives as to what the norms are here and what is appropriate and what isn't. Right now, we've sort of lost the handle on that concept, and so it can degenerate into a bit more of a free-for-all on the floor than most of us think is appropriate or necessary. I think we've got the raw materials of intelligence and goodwill and good sense to change that culture, create a different, over time, a different, restore, I should say, a different norm, and that will get at the problem that you've identified.
One of the things that we've discussed in this series of hearings is the issue of reform of the ethics process. And we know that there have been some charges and countercharges filed, and God knows Porter Goss has worked diligently to address a lot of the problems that have come up there. But I wonder if we're going to be able to bring about bipartisanship and greater civility on issues if we don't reform the ethics process. I wonder if you see a correlation there.
Thank you. Can I take you back? I can't get into the ethics issue because it's always bothered me that there was even such a thing called an ethics committee. But obviously, I know it. And anybody who's on it carries a big cross on his or her back. It's difficult. But it seems to me that when you get together with divergent groups, whether it's union and management or in an intellectual setting or political, that you try to separate out those things which you can't agree on and concentrate on those things which you can't agree on. And when we concentrate on those, I think that there'll be a wellspring of feeling of trying to work closer together, which then will spread into other areas. And it may not work, but how else do you start it?
Well, Porter and I have been struggling with this for some time. I don't think that the difficulty in the ethics process necessarily results from the process itself. It is an awkward process because it deals with awkward substance. I think it has been made more difficult, however, in the course of the last couple of years by the divisions that exist outside that committee rather than the work that goes on inside it. And I think the best solutions really go to the core of the divisions that exist here, and what in some circumstances inevitably is a combative motive that leads to ethics complaints as opposed to necessarily the substance. That's not easily resolved. I'm not sure that it's done by process alone. Some of it simply has to be done by goodwill.
Thank you very much. Mr. Solomon.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for bypassing the other co-chairman here, because I am going to have to leave in just a few minutes. But I just can't commend all of you enough. The four of you, I think, epitomize what members of Congress should be in conducting themselves on the floor. I don't recall any of you ever losing your temper, maybe being carried away by the debate. I know that's happened to me on a few occasions, and so I admire you for your restraint. However, here in this committee, you know, this is the most partisan political committee of the Congress. And every debate that you see take place on the floor of Congress has already taken place here in this committee. David, you've been here many times. And we're very proud of the fact, looking at Tony Beilinson over here and Tony Hall, who just walked out, Joe Moakley, and even the chairman of the National Democratic Congressional Committee. We have never had a shouting match here in the last couple of years, even though we debate the issues here and we have to fight for the individual rights of our party members. But we're very proud of that, and we would like to carry that on to the floor and have it work, come out the same way. I just won't take up any more time, David, but we appreciate your coming here. We hope that you're going to be successful, and I signed on to your letter, David, in the very beginning, and we want to help you in every way we can. Thank you for the good work that you're doing.
So do you want to say, Jerry, that you have not shouted in the last 2 years?
On this committee.
Oh, okay.
Always smile. Smiles were worth everything.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple of comments, if I may. One reason, I mean, this is all stuff you all know anyway, but one reason that what you're all up to is so important, it seems to me, is that it's likely that next year whoever is in charge, whichever party wins, will win by a very narrow majority. It's going to be a smaller majority, I suspect, if the Republicans, you know, hang on to the House than you have now, and if somehow the Democrats win, it'll probably be by a 5 or 6 or 7 vote majority, which means obviously that if anything useful is to be done, it's going to have to be done by members of both parties working together. And for that to happen, as you all don't need to be told, a change in the climate of relationships within the House is necessary in order for that to occur. It was a shame this year, it seemed to me and to many other members, for example, that there wasn't some way, and it was one of the things we spoke about briefly last week at our hearing here in the Rules Committee about potential reforms of finding some nonpartisan way, some different way to act legislatively to get things done. I started to say it was clear to many of us, I thought, that there were probably 100, 120 Democrats, 100, 120 Republicans who could have agreed on a balanced budget plan a few months ago, but it wasn't the Democratic plan, it wasn't the Republican plan, there was no way of getting it on the floor. But if we had gotten something, you know, in the middle on the floor, it would have passed and we would have solved that problem. And we're going to have to find, you all going to have to find some way next year, it seems to me, to do that. And secondly and finally, on a personal note, I must tell you that it makes me feel very, very much better and very good indeed that folks such as yourselves are working so hard to improve the climate around here. From the perspective of myself and some of our other colleagues who are leaving this year, I really think that what you're doing is going to make a difference. Personal relationships, in fact, are the key to whether or not this place works. I'll tell you, just giving you our own example. My wife and I have been privileged the last 10 years or so, every couple of years, of being invited by the three groups that put on that orientation when everybody was invited down at Williamsburg to come and talk about how to be a congressional family and to take care of you know, take care of your family matters and your private matters, as well as being a good member of Congress. But in the process, we've come to meet all the new members in the last few years, especially a lot of new Republican members. And simply because of that, she and I are personal friends with all kinds of new members who most of the older members have never met or have never spent a weekend with or any time with. It's made all the difference in the world. I know them and they know me, so we call each other by our first names from the first day that we're here. And we think of one another as friends. We remember this time we spent back in Williamsburg one evening having supper together with our wives, our spouses. And just that little connection has made a huge amount of difference. I'm sure that what you're doing will make a large difference too. So I'm glad you're doing it, and we encourage you to continue with your efforts.
Thank you. Mr. Goss.
Thank you. I agree, I think, with my colleague, Mr. Sawyer, that it's going to be more than a mechanical process fix that is going to solve the problem. I think it is a cultural question, and I agree with Mr. Skaggs that if we can get to that, the Nobel Peace Prize should be liberally dispersed about all those who helped make it happen. But I think that the specifics of the proposal that you've come forward and the efforts you've taken, I think, are very useful and a positive step. But I think they're a manifestation of something that most members feel. I think the great majority of members feel that, and I think this is a good way to sort of symbolize that, and I think it will have positive direct results as well. And I suspect that part of the effort would be, and I haven't involved myself in your planning for the specific event we're talking about, but I presume that follow-on is clearly part of it, because the danger of, we did that. We had comedy. We did it on January 5th, and it was fun, and now we're going to do something else. I think you have to make a commitment to this all the time, and that's part of the culture, and I'm sure that's part of your planning. And I thank you for bringing what I think is a very useful, specific proposal forward, and I suspect most members who hear of this will thank you also.
Thank you. Mr. Linder. Amo? Yeah.
Comedy, working together, is a personal attitude. And I just want to say, before we leave this chamber, that the person who has epitomized this on the Democratic side more than anyone I know, and we're going to miss very much next year, is Mr. Beilinson.
It's the first time it's been said in this room since he got his retirement.
Thank you. I apologize for missing part of your presentation, but I'm very well acquainted with your proposal and think it's a great idea. I'll simply say, as a new member, I was distressed this year at some of the things that I saw going on, both on and off the House floor, and was struck very much when we completed our energy and water appropriations bill, and there was a salute to the two retiring gentlemen who had headed up both sides of the aisle on that committee, and at the great friendship that they clearly had with each other, and the fact that as a result, that particular appropriations bill has been one that has generally sailed through with little controversy. And Mrs. Vukanovich, who's here with us, commented to me on the floor of the House, that's how it used to be everywhere. And so I'm hopeful that rather than institutionalizing what seems to be a gradually more partisan attitude in the House, that we can reach back toward the time when there was true comedy, and I think your proposal takes a large step in the right direction. So thank you.
Thank you very much. And let me just ask that we spent an hour together, and I'm privileged to be part of the group. And one of the things that we did say is that we would use this forum to outline some of the details that we had resolved. And I wondered if you'd like to do that, David.
Just very quickly, and by the way, Mr. Chairman, we will be getting a letter around to our colleagues in the House later today that brings them up to date on our tentative cut on some of these things. Right now, we're looking at the weekend of February 28th to March 2nd in 1997.
Mm-hmm.
For various reasons, that appeared to the group to be the most likely time frame to plan for. Right now, tentatively, we have focused on the Hershey Lodge and Conference Center in Hershey, Pennsylvania, which is able to accommodate as large a group as we hope we will be at a reasonable cost. We have had very, very fruitful preliminary discussions with the Pew Charitable Trusts, and their representatives have been most generous and encouraging about the likelihood that Pew will basically underwrite this project. Very important, I think, that there be no taxpayer money involved. We're debating whether there should be a portion of the cost covered by participating members for various reasons. Hopefully we will be able to work out rail transportation, but that's still a ways off. And we are just beginning a process of really opening ourselves as a planning group to some brainstorming and outside resource folks with ideas about what an agenda for a unique and really unprecedented meeting like this ought to look like, and we are most anxious to get all the help and counsel we can on that point especially.
Mm-hmm. Well, it sounds terrific, and again, I'm great.
Can we just announce, too, that the other members include Eva Clayton and Charlie Stenholm have also been appointed, yourself and Tilly Fowler from Florida, and the four of us. So the eight of us will be the planning group.
Great. And Tom?
Let me just add one other thing, that in as much as these proceedings are often seen far beyond this chamber, that we would solicit the thoughtful contributions, ideas, suggestions of people far beyond this chamber.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
And that is an active request that we make not only of other members, but of citizens of this country.
Mm-hmm. It's against the House rules to, from the floor, address the C-SPAN audience, but since we are being covered by C-SPAN and we're in a hearing room, I don't know, Walter, if it's a violation of the rules here for us to say to the American people who are following this that if they have any recommendations as to how we can encourage our bipartisanship, I won't start announcing email addresses or our web, but I think people do know how to get in touch with us, and we do want a wide range of input on it because, as you said, David, this clearly is unprecedented. And we hope very much that it will go a long way towards improving the operations of this institution. I congratulate all four of you and my other three colleagues who have joined with us in this effort, and look forward to working with you in the coming months. Thank you all for being here. Thank you. That was very nice, Emil. We say it every day about Tony. Yeah, and he deserves it. Our next panel will include Barbara Vukanovich and Henry Waxman, who are part of the Corrections Day Advisory Group. Barbara chairs the Corrections Day Advisory Group, and we all know this was a proposal that was brought forward to look at idiotic and crazy laws and problems that have been created from regulations and other things, and so we have established this Corrections Day procedure as a way to, as expeditiously as possible, address those. We'd like to welcome you, Barbara, and your statement will appear in the record, and you're welcome to summarize or present it however you wish. And you might want to...
Oh, okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'd like to... Good morning, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to... make this reduced a little bit, but since this will be our last report, I'd like to at least come up with some ideas and talk to you about what some of the suggestions that I have. And I'd certainly like to thank you and the committee for holding the hearing today and your interest in learning about how we manage this Congress with the new procedure known as a Corrections Day. And as you mentioned, Mr. Dreyer, this Corrections Day is the inspiration of Speaker Gingrich to expedite legislative procedure and get rid of outdated or ridiculous rules and laws or regulations that plague Americans. And I'd like to thank the Speaker for his creativity in working to make our lives less cumbersome and less intrusive. And I especially want to thank him for giving me the opportunity to chair this innovative and effective Corrections Day Advisory Group. It's also been an honor and a privilege to serve with my co-chairs, Mr. Zeliff and Mr. McIntosh. Mr. Waxman and the other eight members of the advisory group in making this process a success. And as we all know, change is never easy to implement, especially in the legislative process. However, I believe Corrections Day has worked, and I'm very pleased with what we've accomplished this Congress. Our record is good, Mr. Chairman, and I'm pleased to report that to date, 18 bills have been brought to the House floor under the Corrections Day process. 10 bills have been signed into law, and 8 have passed the House and await further action in the Senate. Perhaps even more importantly, many of the bills we considered prompted the executive branch bureaucracy to make the change administratively. And it was our experience that, faced with the prospect of the House moving to pass Corrections Day legislation, an administrative decision was made to make the change before we would change it legislatively.
Clearly, we have the attention of the executive branch, and I dare say they're very interested in what we're all about. Mr. Chairman, the Corrections Day rule has been good for the Corrections Day process during the 104th Congress. However, I'd like to suggest three proposed changes to the corrections calendar rule that would provide flexibility for floor management. First, allow the speaker to call the bills on the corrections calendar out of numerical order. This would allow the speaker to change the order of consideration of corrections bills to accommodate the manager or sponsor of the bill. Secondly, allow intervening businesses between the Pledge of Allegiance and the call of the corrections calendar. This would give the speaker the authority to consider business before the call of the corrections calendar. Often, simple scheduling problems can be avoided by moving legislation to later in the day. Finally, allow recorded votes on an amendment or recommittal to be postponed. This would allow the speaker to postpone votes ordered on a correction until the next day. This could be helpful on a week like this one, where votes ordered Tuesday were postponed until Wednesday. Mr. Chairman, the Speaker's Corrections Day Advisory Group has worked together in a bipartisan manner. A new process is never easy. However, we have had and will continue to have great success. I can honestly tell you from my experience as the chair to the Corrections Day Advisory Group that the American people want, indeed they are demanding, a government that can fix problems without years of legislative study. One that can effect instead of hinder common sense changes to obvious glitches in the current law. Corrections Day has worked, and it's achieving the goal of meeting the people's demand for a smarter, more efficient government. With your committee's help, we have successfully embarked on this new process, and I'm optimistic that with these few changes I've outlined, future Congresses will achieve even greater results. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'd like to ask unanimous consent that additional statements of members of the advisory group be made part of the record.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Barbara, for your fine work, and let me say that you will be, like Tony Bielenson, sorely missed when the 105th Congress meets, and it's been a privilege for me to be a member of the Corrections Day Advisory Group, and I've enjoyed working with you and look forward to seeing it continue. We're happy to welcome my California colleague, Mr. Waxman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, for inviting me to come before you and talk about the Corrections Day calendar. I have a statement that I'd like to have on the record. When this idea was first proposed, I was a skeptic about it. I was concerned that the Corrections Day calendar would be used as a fast track for special interest bills that wouldn't otherwise get the full consideration they deserved and which were, in fact, controversial and shouldn't be on a Corrections Day calendar. I'm pleased to report that I think the Corrections Day process has worked well. And to a great extent, the reason it's worked well is because of our chairman, Mrs. Vukanovich, because
thank you.
She has handled the committee in a fair way, trying to get the Corrections Day process to do exactly what was intended, to take rules and regulations that don't make sense, are duplicative or superfluous, that need just genuine corrections without having to wait for a whole massive piece of legislation to move it forward. And for the most part, the Corrections Day calendar has worked the way it's intended, and the best example of that was legislation that we passed through that would have corrected the ride-sharing provisions under the Clean Air Act, allowing the states a lot more flexibility. And the Corrections Day calendar was a way to correct a problem in the Clean Air Act itself. But there have been times when the Corrections Day calendar was used for bills that were controversial and shouldn't have been on there. The most significant one of that was a bill that would have repealed the minimum wage for certain workers. This was placed on the Corrections Day calendar over the objections of many Democrats, myself included. Unfortunately, it was pulled from the floor schedule at the last minute. Another bill would have weakened the authority of the Fish and Wildlife Service. It was placed on the Corrections Day calendar despite strong opposition of the ranking member of the committee and subcommittee and opposition by the administration and environmental groups. Without speaking to the merits of those bills, they just shouldn't have been on a corrections calendar. Despite the fact that corrections legislation is intended to have a narrow scope and significant external and bipartisan support, too many bills that come before the advisory committee are controversial, and they're strongly opposed by either a federal agency or affected interest groups. Much of our time on that committee has been to listen to those bills without even having the expertise of the committee involved with the jurisdiction. And one of the dangers of this committee is that, I don't know if our meetings are open or not, but no one is there except the members of the committee, our staffs, and the advocates for the bills. We're not getting the opposition because the opposition doesn't know about a hearing. So we often might hear one side of the case and think it's non-controversial, when in fact we find out later it was controversial. One way to, I think, correct this kind of problem is to have a stronger coordination between the committees of jurisdiction over the issue and the advisory committee for the correction state calendar. I think it's wise that we have the committee of jurisdiction review all legislation, but sometimes we're asked to make a judgment before any other committee's heard the bill whether it fits into the correction state calendar. Because this is an expedited procedure, a lot of people think this is great. It'll move their bill through very rapidly, even though they are convinced their bill is a good bill. Most authors are, but the danger is that in fact it might be a controversial bill and shouldn't be on this calendar. Most members who offer a bill to change the law think they're correcting the problems in the law, either because there hasn't been a law on the subject or they want to change the existing law. But I don't think that's what any of us meant when we said we're going to correct the government regulations that don't make sense. I think one result of this process has been, despite the fact when the Speaker announced this Corrections Day, he envisioned it as a way to perfect and fix profoundly dumb laws or regulations, I think he had in mind there are a lot more than really have come forward. Now, that isn't to say there aren't more that we need to correct, but I think that there are amazingly few laws and regulations that are profoundly dumb. If anything, the Corrections Day has revealed that our government is doing a much better job than some might suspect. One interesting aside on this process is that when we organized the Corrections Day process, I met with some of the people at EPA and other regulatory agencies with which I had some dealings, and they were enthusiastic at the idea of correcting some of their rules and regulations that they didn't think made any sense. I think we ought to invite them to be more of a part of the process, and often those corrections have no interest group to back them, but they are corrections that are needed nevertheless. I listened a few minutes ago to Mrs. Pekanovich's suggestions for changes. They all sounded like a good idea. I might recommend that since we're really looking at non-controversial bills, I think the advisory committee is simply a recommendation to the speaker with the speaker's sole decision. Perhaps it ought to be an advisory committee recommendation with the committee of jurisdiction's approval, and then I think both the minority leader and the speaker ought to agree to a bill going on the Corrections Day calendar so that it really does pass the test of a non-controversial bill. If it's a bill with some opposition, it can go on the suspension calendar, or it can go on the regular calendar. But let's not let this process, which I think has worked well, again, primarily, I think, because of leadership we've had from our chairman, but let's not let this process go awry, because it could easily go awry if people abuse it and start using it for bills that are inappropriate.
Well, thank you very much, Henry, and let me say it's been a privilege to work with you on the Corrections Day Advisory Panel, and frankly, I just as I was listening to you, was remembering on more than one occasion when you and I have sat and together said, this is something that should not be brought up under the, I'm not going to mention the legislation, but should not be brought up under the Corrections Day Advisory Group. So I think that there has been a sense of bipartisanship, and the skepticism that you brought to the process was very healthy and helpful, and I think brings, because of your skepticism, I think that the statement you have made very, very well received here. And one thing that I would say is that I mentioned earlier that we have conducted a survey of committee chairmen and ranking minority members, and 71% of the committee chairmen and ranking minority members indicated that they felt that the Corrections Day advisory group was being the process was being underutilized at this point, and they'd like to actually see it used more, which I found to be rather interesting. And also,
well, they might be advised to give us recommendations to move things on that calendar.
Surely, I mean, and they obviously are free to. But I mean,
more one-sided, I think.
Right.
I don't recall too many committees initiating corrections.
Right. But it is interesting that came forward in that survey, and we probably, our panel should probably play a role in encouraging committee chairmen and ranking minority members to take advantage of it if they see fit. One thing you mentioned the suspension calendar, and early on there was a question of whether or not the items that the Correction Day Advisory Group would address if they couldn't simply be handled under the procedure of the suspension calendar. And I wonder if you feel that, both of you, that we've been able to establish a real justification for this along with the suspension calendar.
There's not a very clear line, in my view, to what could go on one calendar as opposed to another. And I don't think there is any clear demarcation. But if we look at the corrections calendar as a way to actually correct laws and regulations that just don't make any sense, I think we can move forward on non-controversial bills. The suspension calendar is more of a policy change. There may even be some controversy in that policy change, but it's a policy change nevertheless, which has enough bipartisan agreement where the authors are willing to go to the floor and get two-thirds without any opportunity for amendment. So I think that there's a need for both. This shouldn't be a replacement for suspension, and I don't think suspension calendar has to be a replacement for the corrections calendar.
No, and I think, Mr. Chairman, that it has worked as we had hoped that it would. Most of the things that we finally have brought under the Corrections Day process have been really non-controversial and have been small things that probably nobody would bother bringing under the suspension process. So I think it's worked very well. And like anything new, it's going to take a little while to see how it works. But I think overall it's been very helpful when you consider that we have passed and had things signed into law.
Mr. Chairman, first of all, Barbara, let me commend you. As David said, he and I served on your committee along with Henry, and I think you did a spectacular job. We certainly are going to miss you. You are from my home area, Albany, New York, believe it or not, and even though you're the representative from Nevada. And we're going to miss you and George because you're personal friends. And Henry, I just want to commend you too, because you and in your capacity on the committee, I think have been a real asset. We mentioned that there had not been that many bills that had been successfully put forth. And that's good, because that means the committee was doing its job. And it means that you did scrutinize the legislation. I believe there were a couple of dozen bills that we actually decided had merit and that we acted on. And I think out of those couple of dozen or whatever they were, I think 10 or 12 of them have now become law. So it isn't that we were rushing hell-bent for leather to pass all these bills. We were being deliberative, and I think the committee did a good job. And Henry, the other, or let me get back to Barbara, your suggestion to call up bills out of order, you know, I think is excellent. That is something that we can do. We can make that rules change without any, I think, much difficulty if it's within the wisdom of this committee, and I think it probably would be. So it's a very good suggestion. And Henry, on the same thought, when you talked about some of the bills that might have been controversial, it's important to point out that we only on that committee only consider reported bills. In other words, they have had their hearing, they've had their airing under the normal committee procedure. And I think that's good, and I think we ought to keep it that way. We should not be originating legislation and reporting legislation to the floor that has not gone before the respective committees, because after all, they do have the expertise, and they should be they should have the jurisdiction. Having said all that, we appreciate your coming before us. We appreciate the good job you've done, and we hope that we can improve it and keep it in effect for the new Congress coming along. Thank you
very much, Mr. Bielans.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. We do appreciate your testimony. It's particularly helpful to persons like myself, who I guess along with Mr. Waxman was really quite skeptical of the idea at the outset. First, very quickly, is it true what our chairman has just suggested, that all of these bills first go through their own committees before they get to you?
They do go to the committees. We recommend.
You recommend.
Well, and it's up to the committee to make the determination whether they need anything further, whether they want to continue and send it on to the.
Do they have hearings on them as such or not? Do you know? Do the committees of jurisdiction have hearings on these bills?
Well, they have the choice of whether they need hearings. Isn't that correct? I think that they do. They can or cannot have hearings.
So you pick the bill first, then goes to the committee?
That's correct.
Well, that's good. I didn't know that. That's obviously a makes things a lot better than they might otherwise be.
One of the issues that came up was that we're presented with the bill for the first time. Right. We've only, at that occasion, hear from the author.
Sure.
Will tell us this is a genuine corrections. Some of us on our own would try to find out if there was opposition. Oftentimes we found out there was opposition. Sometimes opposition that didn't fully understand the bill.
Sure.
And we're often called on at the first instance to say this ought to be on the corrections day calendar or not. But even if we say it ought to be on the calendar, it goes to the committee. It puts us in a position of making a judgment which should be considered only preliminary. But I think a lot of people misunderstand what our role is, what I think our role should be at that point. But before the bill goes to the floor, it does go to the committee. But we've had bills that were reported out of committees by a sharp division, close division.
That did go on the corrections calendar?
Partisan division.
That did go.
And then still went on the corrections day calendar. There were a few.
Yeah.
But it really shouldn't happen.
Maybe there should be some way at that point for them to be diverted to the suspension calendar if the author wants that. But
well, that's why I think if you ask the minority leader to sign
off. Yeah, no, I agree. Well, that was going to be my next question, if I might. Mr. Waxman, Barbara, Madam Chairman, Chairperson, made a couple of suggestions which sounded good to me, but I thought I'd ask you about them. One was that the minority leader, whomever he or whatever party he or she might represent, would have to sign off on this, and also some suggestion with respect to the Committee of Jurisdiction, but that may already have been in effect, wasn't that your other suggestion, Henry?
Yes, I think there ought to just be a better coordination. And the reason I suggest the minority leaders, right now, as I understand the rules, we're only advising a speaker, and a speaker can take anything he wants and put on a suspension calendar. And I don't think it ought to be so that arbitrary.
Well, let me ask you this. I just asked a question. I'm not letting you answer. But let's say the speaker suggests to you all, or you suggest to him, that certain bills go on the corrections calendar. Then it goes for a hearing or not, but at least for discussion perhaps to the Committee of Jurisdiction. And if what if the Committee of Jurisdiction feels differently about it? Does it just stop there?
If the committee feels differently about it, it isn't going to come back to the corrections day calendar. They're going to, in other words, for instance, something that's referred to Ways and Means, they may feel that it really is something that they should continue to have control over, and therefore they wouldn't let it go that way.
So they're involved in the decision.
Yes, because we make the recommendation, right. But it does go to the committee, and it is up to the committee to say whether it's to go on the corrections day calendar.
If I may, just Mr. Chairman, please bear with me. Let me ask just two or three more questions, because I've not been involved in the process myself, and wanted to ask about how it actually works. Okay. How exactly is the decision to place a bill on the corrections calendar actually made? You have an advisory board?
We do.
Does it meet pretty frequently?
We meet when we have several bills to be considered.
Do most of the members come, Barbara? Or a decent number of them?
Yes, quite often. I would say once or twice that we have not had the representation, but most of the time it's been pretty well attended.
Okay, so who initiates the whole process? An author has a bill which he or she believes?
An author has a bill, and they ask us to consider it under the Corrections Day
process. So it goes to you and your board first, and then to the Speaker?
Well, we refer to the Speaker for the Corrections Day calendar, but it really goes to the Committee of Jurisdiction.
But the preliminary decision is yours, your group's decision.
Yes, but very often something has already been considered by a committee and nothing has happened.
Right.
And so it has come to our attention, perhaps from the sponsor of the amendment or the legislation, and ask us to consider it under the Corrections Day process because it has bogged down, for instance, or it hasn't been top priority for a committee.
Okay. Second question. As I recall, the definition of a corrections bill was somewhat vague and subjective when we first adopted this process. Have you changed the definition at all, or having worked with that relatively vague definition, do you have any suggestions for changing it, or is it adequate the way it is?
Well, I'm very satisfied with the way it is. I think it is workable, and we have been able to do this under the procedure and with our advisory committee, but I don't see any need for change, but that may be something that we need to look at next time.
Okay. And again, it's a question which Mr. Waxman at least spoke to, and maybe Mr. our chairman asked about, but you know, many of us keep coming back to this. If there's any real purpose that serve by placing these bills on a separate calendar, whether or not there'd be some way to coordinate it with a suspension calendar, maybe even to make the suspension calendar into something new that an advisory group such as yours would first suggest bills go on. I mean, you seem to be serving a useful purpose in moving some things along that in the past chairmen or chairwomen haven't wanted to touch or haven't wanted to move, but it may be that we don't need two separate calendars. It just may be that we need a suspension corrections calendar, and a group such as yours might be a good group to move more things onto it.
If I might respond to that, there are regulations that don't make sense. We found out that the Food and Drug Administration had to keep a list of reactions to medical devices. And the same list had to be kept by another government agency. Completely useless, duplicative process. Now, if the agency wanted to change its regulations, it would have to send out a notice of comment, hold it for, I don't know, 90 days, or whatever the administrative process is, go through a lot of red tape just to repeal a duplicative rule. I think the purpose of this committee was to highlight the fact that we want to, as the Congress, exercise oversight to the point where not just the major issues, but these minor, silly things ought to be taken care of and disposed of in a rapid way. And so
these are lesser matters, in a sense, than the policy changes that would be on a suspension calendar.
That, I think, is the important thing.
Okay.
They're small, non-controversial matters, and we ought to keep a focus on that because we ought to make government more efficient by eliminating some of these nonsensical rules. Now, when the idea was proposed, ironically enough, it was proposed by the Speaker for a regulation that he considered superfluous and nonsensical, but in fact, many of us disagreed with him. It was over a sewage dumping system in San Diego, which was very, very controversial.
Cost
and it should not have
dollars.
Been on the Corrections Day calendar.
Whatever happened to it?
It's a good question. I know we passed it. I don't know if the Senate ever passed it.
They still don't have a sewage system in San Diego.
Well, they had one. There was a question of whether they were going to have. I won't get into it. But anyway, I think a focus on this kind of correcting problems is a worthwhile one, separate from the suspension calendar. But we ought to make sure that it is genuinely non-controversial. To share with you my frustration. You and I served in the California legislature.
Right.
In the California legislature, and probably most state legislatures, the committee members sit at the rostrum, and a member, colleague of theirs, will come forward with a bill. And it's an open hearing, and the bill has been noticed in some register, and anyone who wants to oppose it can come in and make their case. Our committee is operated with the members sitting there, no public's involved in the hearing, and no opposition's ever informed that a bill's being discussed. So we don't get a balanced presentation to us as to whether it's non-controversial or not. We have to make some initial judgment about it. Now, luckily, it then goes to the Committee of Jurisdiction. But we always have that dilemma. Do we call it a Corrections Day issue and then tell the committee there's a Corrections Day issue, we want you to act on it? They could say no, but we are putting a lot of pressure on them. Are we locking ourselves into putting on the calendar when later we shouldn't have it on the calendar? That's not an insurmountable problem. It's just one that has bothered me. And the reason it hasn't been a difficult problem is because I think our chairman has,
exactly,
has tried to be mindful of it.
But it's a nation of laws
abused
rather than of individual human beings, and we might not be so lucky with the next chairman. So you do have to put up some kind of procedure that tries to ensure that you're really dealing with bills that ought to be on such a calendar.
One other comment: very often an agency themselves is frustrated by some rule or regulation, and they're very happy to have us deal with it, but. We have tried to vent this process and talk about it, and originally we didn't even ask sponsors of the bills to come and explain it and to talk about it, but as we worked through it, we felt that that was the thing to do, and conceivably we may look at, if there is opposition, we might find ways to advise opposition. But we have tried to deal with things that really come up that are non-controversial.
Thanks. Mr. Chair, may I ask one quick additional question? Mr. Waxman suggested something earlier, and Ms. Akonovich just sort of touched on it, which seems to me to be extremely useful, potentially at least, and that is whether or not you shouldn't do, I take it you don't sort of circulate amongst the bureaucrats questionnaires suggesting or eliciting suggestions from them as to what one ought to do with, but as you suggested, Henry, I mean, if you work in any large organization, you become aware after some time of some totally nonsensical things, more so than we'd ever know about or hear about, and it may be that in future, one might, you know, carefully and selectively ask some of the bureaus and some of the program managers and some of the departments if there aren't such things that that they think ought to be done away with, and have them come and present them to you.
We might be overwhelmed. Who knows?
I know, but you could do an immense amount of good work in a very short period of time, perhaps, to clear away some underbrush that really serves no purpose at all.
It's a good idea.
Good idea.
I think that was really the intention behind the establishment of the whole Corrections Day procedure, and any way that we can encourage greater participation is helpful. I will say that one important distinction that exists between the suspension of the calendar, the suspension of rules, and there's not a calendar on the suspension of rules, and the Corrections Day procedure, is that under the Corrections Day procedure, we do, as you said in your statement, Barbara, have an opportunity for a recommittal motion, which the minority can offer. So that is one more way to address some of the understandable concerns. This obviously is a completely new process. The reason that we're sitting here is that today is that we want to do what we can to try and figure out a way to even build on what I'm happy to say you see as a success so far, with a few exceptions, Henry. And so I again thank both of you and appreciate the opportunity to serve as a member of the advisory panel. And I think we have a meeting this afternoon, don't we?
Yes, we do.
Okay, so we'll look forward to seeing you at this afternoon's meeting. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Our next panel will consist of our colleagues, the gentleman from Virginia, Mr. Wolf, and the gentleman from Indiana, Mr. Romer. And they are going to talk about the Family Quality of Life Advisory Committee, which was put together, another idea of the speakers at the beginning of this Congress. And I know there are a wide range of recommendations that they made early on, and we look forward to hearing from both of you. You can proceed as you wish. Mr. Wolf, your entire statement will appear in the record, and you're welcome to summarize.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me just turn the microphone
on. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. At the outset, I appreciate you even inviting us. I don't mean any criticism of anybody with regard to my testimony. I want to put that out on the record. I don't mean to be critical of anybody. I just want to be an honest person on this issue. This Congress has been extremely difficult for many members, the staff and families. Both sessions have been marked by long days and nights, contentious debate, ambitious legislative agendas. Our efforts to enact broad reforms and sweeping initiatives have exacted a significant toll on far too many of our colleagues, staff, and families, and I bet a lot of kids. I know many who have struggled greatly under the enormous burdens imposed by the House schedule.
The House leadership did try to respond to the needs of the members and staff by adopting some reforms and improvements in the House schedule, and I believe the House leadership was sincere. But I must say, the House is not family-friendly. Let me just say it again. The House is not, under any circumstances, family-friendly. The House began adhering, where possible, to a public schedule, starting sessions earlier in the morning when possible, rolling votes, ending sessions earlier on a getaway on Friday, and instituting a Tuesday to Thursday schedule for floor business. There were some good intentions, but much, much more is needed. We need to balance the needs of the members who are anxious to conclude legislative business early most days so they can spend their families. Now, one suggestion was to stay very, very late Wednesday night, but on other nights, get out in a reasonable time that you could go home and see your husband, see your wife, see your kids, read a book, call your mom, call your dad, but have a normal life except for that Wednesday night. We have a problem of balancing between members who say, my family's back home, I'm coming here, if you're here, just keep me whatever, versus the member who's here and has his family here, but also has to go back to their congressional district. There's a difficulty of balancing the conflict here, but we need to keep in mind we have to represent all the members. My own personal view is that I honestly don't know if we can ever have truly a family-friendly Congress. I don't know if we can balance the legislative business of the nation against the individual personal needs of members and staff. But having said that, I do know that we must continue to work to make the Congress a more family-friendly place. We must remain committed to making Congress a more family place, one which enables members and staff to be successful representatives and successful staff people, as well as successful spouses, fathers, mothers, sons, and daughters. We owe this effort to ourselves. We owe it to our staffs. We owe it, more importantly, to our family and to those who would aspire to follow us on Capitol Hill. We all think that we're so important sometimes, but the only place that we will truly be missed when we leave will be in our family. I never hear people say, I wish Jim Wright were back. I very seldom hear them say, I wish Bob Michael were back. I don't hear them say, I wish Tip O'Neill were back. I don't hear them saying, I wish that Lyndon Johnson were back. But the only place you're really missed, they won't even say, I wish that Tony Bilison were back. No, they won't, to be honest.
I will.
You will, but you won't. The truth of the matter is, when you're gone, out of sight, out of mind, the only place that Tony Bilison will be missed is in his family. The only place that you'll be missed will be in your family. So that's the fundamental thing. If we give up on our efforts to establish a more family-friendly Congress, we essentially concede that on Capitol Hill, no one can be successful in either his or her professional or personal life, but not both. What kind of legislators, what kind of spouses, what kind of sons and daughters and fathers and mothers will we then become? Let's not throw in the towel on the effort to successfully meet both the professional needs and the private needs. Success in establishing a more family-friendly working environment requires a strong leadership from the House leadership on both sides of the aisle. If this Congress has not been family-friendly, and it is not, the fault rests with the leadership in some respects on both sides and on all committees, and lastly, on all the members of the House. It is not uncommon to hear a member say, why couldn't you get us out early last night, Wolf? And then all of a sudden, the last week, he was the member that was calling for roll call votes, keeping us here and demanding things. So it isn't only the leadership if you're going to have a family. We need the leadership on both sides, but we also need the rank and file members to commit that they will make sure that they are family friendly. Just because it's your anniversary, you won't get home on Wednesday night. It may have been somebody else's mom's birthday last Wednesday night, and they wanted to go home. While leadership on both sides of the aisle must lead the way, all members have a responsibility to the House and to the colleagues as well as to further these efforts. Where possible, all members should work to focus floor debate, limit debate, enter into time agreements, elect not to debate and re-debate every issue. The House members and staff should not be held hostage to the whims of members who would force everyone to stay in session to debate issues whose outcome is a foregone conclusion. family-friendly is a responsibility of not just the leadership, but all members. And quite frankly, if the leadership failed, the whole rank and file failed. Of course, all members must understand, as legislators, we have entered into an unpredictable business. There will be times when Congress must remain in session to debate critical issues on weekends, on Saturdays, late at night. Desert Storm, Desert Shield, major issues. I mean, there are times if you want to come to have a 9-to-5 job, don't run for Congress. But it doesn't have to be every day. It only has to be on those times. At the recent political conventions, both parties offered strong pro-family platforms and policies. And I believe it is vital that the espoused pro-family views represent the true positions of the parties. It is important that the parties not only talk the pro-family talk, but they also walk the pro-family talk by living a relatively normal life. If we are so busy meeting the needs of the country that we neglect our own needs or those of our families, our views become skewered. It's like the corporate CEO for IBM who has a chauffeur to drive him to work and then wonders why there's a traffic problem his other employees. I mean, he should get into traffic. We should live basically the same type of lives that our constituents live. Many members have suggested additional changes. Let me just cover them. Start legislative sessions earlier in the day. Most members come in very early. Both parties, this is a hard-working group of men and women. Start earlier. End legislative sessions at a reasonable hour every day while setting one night whereby we go on into the night, whether it be 12, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning, so members know. Some people say you can't do it because of the paid schools. Hire one or two or three professional people that can fill in during that period of time. Conclude voting on the designated late night on other nights if you have to by 8 or 9, and then roll the votes. And I think the majority leader has been doing a good job when he can get an agreement, but we can't always get the agreement to roll the votes. And one member gets angry. If they want to stay and expound into the night, but as they stay and expound into the night, the staff has to stay. And the staff has husbands and wives and sons and daughters and moms and dads and a family. Roll or cluster roll call votes. Approve modified closed rules to expedite debate. Set time limits on debate on amendments. Sometimes we seem to spend more time on the most irrelevant amendment and a short time on the most important amendment. Adjourn before 7 p.m. when possible, at least one night a week or more, so people can spend time with their families, or if their families aren't here, they can go home and read a book. They can watch television. They can call their husband or wife or mom or dad or son or daughter on the phone. Eliminate one-minute speeches at the start of the day in which the House is expected to stay into 9 o'clock. If we know it's a late night, then do not have one-minute speeches which go on. Just limit them. Eliminate special orders when the House session extends beyond 9. Why should we keep the House staff down there listening to special orders when we go by? So if we know we're going to go by 9 o'clock, let the word go out. There will be no special orders. Of course, if adopted, some of these reforms may need to be suspended at the end of the session and at other times when legislative demands dictate longer days and nights. However, suspension of necessary reforms should not be an everyday procedure. Lastly, we have become kind of like the House of Commons. In the House of Commons, they come in late and they stay very late. I just finished reading a book about William Wilberforce, who was a member of the Parliament who was committed to abolishing the slave trade. And William Wilberforce would talk about the debates raging in 1815 at 4:30 a.m. in the morning. But they came in late. So we have now taken the best thing of the U.S. Congress. We come in very early. And we have also taken what the House of Commons does. They stay in very late. And we have merged them together. So now we have become a body who comes in early and stays late. And I think it's hurting members. I think it's hurting their families. I think it's hurting staff. I think it's hurting the comity between the two sides. I think it's developing into more partisanship. I think it's making the place a less desirable place to work. And frankly, not much good takes place on the floor of the House after a certain hour at the night. And I would plead with this committee to make some recommendations to change it. And my last comment is, I mean no criticism of the leadership on either side. I think there is a sincere goal by the leadership to deal with this. It's like the Pogo cartoon. We have met the enemy, and the enemy is us. All of us together have to work, and I think we have failed in this session to be successful there.
I would just ask unanimous consent that my entire statement be entered in, Mr. Chairman. I thank Frank Wolf for his heartfelt statement, and it has been a pleasure to serve with Frank on the Family Advisory Quality of Life Committee that the Speaker and Mr. Gephardt put together as we entered into this new session. I would also say that I adamantly agree with Frank. There's a lot of blame to go around. There's blame to go around to us Democrats when we controlled this body that did not do a very good job putting family-friendly policies first, as we talked about them. And certainly in the last 2 years, there has not been a very good job in terms of implementing a lot of the talk about the values on families. This is not just about the value of family and the quality of life for us as members of Congress. If this place works better, the taxpayer gets better efficiency out of every one of us and out of the tax dollar that they send to Washington. I'd like to tell you two very short, quick stories about what I mean on both the family side for members and also the efficiency side for a predictable schedule and for taxpayers. I am a father and a husband. I have two small children, Patrick, who is 3, and Matthew's 2. We're at the stage with both of them where we're trying to teach them prayers now. We happen to be Catholic. And the other night, we were laying in bed. I was with Patrick in bed trying to teach him the Our Father. He's doing a great job on it. And he's getting through it, and he got to the end of it. Well, those of you familiar with the prayer, the last few lines are, "Deliver us from evil, amen." Well, Patrick says, "And deliver us some eagles, amen." Eagles instead of evil. Now, I think that's probably improvement. How do you tell a 3-year-old what evil is anyway? We all need a little uplifting in our lives. I am fortunate to have my children and my wife. It's the best thing about my job and in terms of the values that I hold dear. I don't want to miss those opportunities of teaching my children the values and the priorities that they need to have in their life. Too often times in this session of Congress, and since I've served in 1991, I miss those opportunities. And it does not have to be that way around here. It gets that way because we do not treat each other with the kind of civility and comedy that we need to. Too often times we don't work in bipartisan ways around here when we could. And too often times people put their own special order or their own 1 minute ahead of the rest of this body and the other 434 people. I think the two can work hand in hand, the values that we hold dear and the efficiencies. Another example of the inefficiency around here, I was walking up to vote with a Republican member of a very powerful committee. He said to me, "Tim, I have not been able to even go to the store for the last month to buy a shirt, because the schedule is so inefficient and so unpredictable." Going from 1 minute where we're in session until midnight for 2 weeks in a row to the next minute where we don't even know what we're doing today in terms of votes and how late we'll be in and how many votes we'll have. How do you run a government? How do you run a life? How do you know when you're going to be with your children when you don't know what you're doing that day? Now, I can't agree more with the saying that if you don't like voting and if you don't like working hard, don't run for Congress. I'm willing to work 12 and 13 and 14-hour days, but it does not have to be so inefficient. It does not have to be so unfriendly to our children and to our families. This place can work better. What do you do? I think one of the first things we need to do is change the schedule. We have a tough time changing the schedule because any time you put forward a new policy, you get 100 people signing onto one proposal and 100 people opposing it right away. One of the best compromises to that is fair and bipartisan and fair to people on the West Coast and the East Coast is to come up with a schedule that's Tuesday through Friday and then Monday through Thursday. You're in 4 days a week. You have three or four days on alternating weekends to be back in your district working hard, representing your people as the Founding Fathers wanted us to do, not necessarily legislating and putting more laws on the books and more regulations, but listening to your people and going door to door and visiting your businesses and listening to your school teachers. That is a fair schedule to people all over the country. Secondly, I think we need to change the 1 minutes. We should not start this august place where many, many good-willed people are serving with the most partisan comments made of the day, every day. I would disagree slightly with Frank and say not to eliminate 1 minutes, but let's move them to the end of the day. Let's not start out every session bashing one another and bashing the president and bashing the opposition party. That makes it very difficult to accomplish things around here. Thirdly, I think we need to rely more on creating a master schedule, a master computer. Many state legislatures do this. Florida has done this for years, where we don't have the committee process conflicting directly almost every day with the floor schedule, so that you have three cabinet secretaries and two CEOs sitting for 2 hours waiting for us to come back from voting on adjourning four times in a row. And we don't get our committee work done, and we're sitting over on the floor voting on some rather insulting measures every now and then. I think we need to coordinate in a better fashion with technology, a master schedule, so we don't constantly have these conflicts. Fourth, I would say let's start the day earlier. We don't need to start at 10 o'clock in the morning. We can start at 8:30 or 9 o'clock in the morning and get the legislative business going so that we can get our committee business going in the morning and then maybe coordinate the floor schedule more in the afternoon. If our constituents start work at 7:30 or 8:30 in the morning, certainly we can do the same thing here. Finally, I would just say, those that are willing to read my testimony, I have more suggestions as to how to make this place more family-friendly for our families, so we don't just talk about values, but we practice those values so our children catch those values. More tax-efficient, so that we run this place in a more efficient manner, so that people have more confidence in their elected representatives, and so that we use the technology that other state legislative bodies are using, so that we're more civil, we have more comedy toward one another, and we can get things done on occasion, when necessary, and oftentimes it is necessary to work in bipartisan ways. I think that this is highly practicable, highly logical, highly doable, and I think that those that continue to put just lip service to this, whether they be in the Democratic or Republican leadership, I would hope that members and the people and the public would just help us and be outraged at that and help us make this place work better. We can be family friendly and we can be work efficient and taxpayer friendly at the same time.
Well, thank you both very much, and I appreciate the passion with which you've both made your statements. To say that, quite frankly, I believe that Frank Wolf said it best, it is going to be difficult for us to do this. I just looked at my watch, it's 7:35 in California. And I've been here for a few hours already. And when people choose to live in their districts rather than the District of Columbia, it's tough. I mean, frankly, if we came in at 8:30 in the morning, that's 5:30 a.m. in California. In a few hours, I'll be back in Los Angeles. I just got in from there day before yesterday. And that does create the problem that Frank raised. And so it is going to be tough for us to resolve this. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't continue to try whenever possible. I have members who will come to me. Frank talked about this late Wednesday night proposal, and they will say, my gosh, I mean, I'm here. I don't have anything else to do. I go back to a cold water flat somewhere on Capitol Hill, and I want to get out of town as quickly as possible so that I can be with my constituents and my family. In Florida, is what was said by a certain member, who doesn't even have to go through the time change. So as we look at the technological advances that have been made in air travel and communication and all, I think that it in many ways is making the process tough. I mean, I remember watching the old movies about the Congress from, you know, Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, Advise and Consent. And I remember in those movies, I mean, people lived here in this town. And they went back to their districts or their states on occasion, and they went home for campaigning. And it's just much different now. So it is tough, and I appreciate the fact that you all have worked so hard on it. We've tried in this committee to deal with a lot of those concerns that are out there. And I will say this, that while it hasn't been perfect in many ways, I mean, I think that in the 104th Congress, that with few exceptions, when it's come to target adjournment dates, we've been pretty much in line. As opposed to staying over an extra 2 or 3 weeks, it remains to be seen whether we adjourn sine die on the 27th of September, the 1st of October, or how late we go. So there have been improvements that have been made over past schedules. I'm running for my 9th term. I was here when it came with Frank. There was real uncertainty during the 1980s. Tony's been here even longer. So I think that we have seen some improvement, and I know that both of you are frustrated because we don't have a perfectly family-friendly structure, but you hit the nail on the head when you said that we're never going to get to that point. But your efforts to try and improve it, I think, are very well received and important. And now I'd like to recognize one of the newest mothers in the institution, Ms. Green.
Thank you. I think this is one of the more difficult things that members deal with personally, because the nature of our job, excuse me, and the nature of the things that we're dealing with don't always lend themselves to perfect predictability. And so I recognize that there will always be circumstances beyond which Congress has no control in terms of having to deal with things on an immediate basis for the good of the nation. At the same time, I share your concern. I was stunned to find myself a single mother this year, and through the help of family and friends, I've managed to make it work. But it is difficult every single day, and I'm concerned that if we don't do a little better job than what we're doing, we will exclude a great number of people from the eligibility to run for office through their decision, which I could not argue with, if someone's saying, I simply can't make this work for my family. And I think it would be a real loss to this institution if the only people who could run for Congress are people who are either single or whose children have grown and left their homes, because I think we need the additional perspective of people at all stages throughout their lives. So I recognize it is a very, very difficult question, one that I'm sure Congress will continue to struggle with. But I think whether or not you feel completely satisfied with the results of what you're doing, I salute you for continuing to raise this as an issue, and hopefully we'll continue to move in the right direction. Thank you.
I just respond to that very briefly. I appreciate that insight from you. And just as this whole Constitution and our whole House of Representatives is set up to represent people from different states, different occupations, different perspectives and viewpoints, certainly one of the most valuable things that we have to represent is our families and our children. And if this body excludes and runs those people out, like the Pete Garrons that make announcements this year that say, I'm retiring as a young man of 40 or 41 years old with 2 children or 3 children because I never see them. That's like running out our farmers out of Congress, and we run out our expertise on the farm bill. We cannot afford to run people out because of families and young children losing that expertise that people relate to with their kids and with the value of family and education and new ideas to help the new generation of children in this country. So I would say that we need to continue to make every effort to improve. And what Frank and I are saying is we don't expect perfection, but we certainly expect it to be better than it is right now. It's miserable right now, not just for families, but I think for the taxpayer.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. I'll be brief. Ms. Green's comments were very much on point. You don't want to have a situation around here in which, in effect, you are limiting the kinds of people who seek and win membership in this House. You want an across-the-board spectrum of men and women, and you don't want to limit to people who are single or have no children, or perhaps, as Ms. Green suggested, are older and whose children already have grown up. And I have nothing much to add to the discussion. It's been well said by one member or another. I too am glad that you're doing this. I hope you keep up the pressure. On the other hand, I must admit to you that I'm sort of two minds about this whole matter. You know, we know what we're getting into when we run for Congress. We know it's a difficult job, and in fact, there are only 435 of us. I mean, there are some commitments we have to make, but there are only a few hundred people in the country who have to put themselves in that difficult position, 435 of us here and 100 over in the Senate. And as I suggested to my people back home often, that I'm only helpful to them, really. I'm their only representative in Washington. If I'm not here, they have nobody here representing them. I have two gentle suggestions, both of which have been brought up, and both of which I think are useful, and neither of which, both of which not everybody agrees with. But one was that I've always discovered that to have a normal life, you have to live at the Capitol. That doesn't fit for everybody. I understand that. But when we were in Sacramento for 14 years, we moved up there, we bought a house, the kids went to public school. I came home and saw them every single night. I went to all their little league games. That wouldn't have happened if they'd stayed in Los Angeles. I go home often enough then, and I do now, to stay in touch with my people. I have town hall meetings. I find that I don't have to live at home or leave my family at home. Now, I know that that's, in order to represent people well, I know that's not possible for some other members. Their spouses have jobs, or the kids are very small, or whatever the reasons are. I understand it doesn't work for everybody, but I think we should encourage people to move their families here. I saw more of my family being a member of the state legislature than I would have if I'd stayed in West Los Angeles or Beverly Hills as a lawyer and worked late every night. I mean, I came home and the kids grew up with the kids and everything was fine. When we came here 20 years ago, we moved everybody here, even though all three children were in the middle of high school. It was a little bit difficult for them, but not terrible. They made a lot of good friends here. We bought a home here. We've lived in that house for 20 years. I go home every evening, whatever time we get out. And of course, when we get out is a problem, Frank, as you quite properly bring out. But I have been able, I mean, we've led a perfectly normal private life being members of the state legislature and being a member of Congress. And I don't think you can do that if your family stays at home. Again, I know some families need to stay at home, or they think they need to stay at home, and I wouldn't argue with you. But the second thing we need to do is exactly what Mr. Romer suggested, is to have 4 or perhaps 5 day sessions every week or every other week, or whatever it is. I happen to like his particular suggestion because it gives you every other long weekend to go home and take care of all your commitments to your constituents and still live basically here and have a couple of weekends here or wherever, here in the Washington area with your children, with your family. And you'll find also, we find these Tuesday to Thursday things do not work for any rationale, under any reason. Including the family-friendly one. If you meet for 4 days a week, your work will get done in the regular time frame. Even if you start at 10 in the morning, you'll be through at 5 or 6 or 7 in the evening. You don't get through, and it's not predictable, if you don't come in and start working until Tuesday evening and you're trying to get out of here early Thursday afternoon. That never works. It never has. It never will. So you need a predictable schedule, and you need one where you're in session for a decent amount of time most weeks, because that'll take care of the work and free people up in the evenings and even early in the mornings. And beyond that, it'll never be perfect, but we can make a lot of improvements, and I think the things that you all have suggested are very much on point.
Well, if I may, I thank the gentleman. I agree with what Enid said. I think we need a cross-section of America to serve here. Secondly, I'm also thinking in terms of the staff and not just the members. Obviously, the staff can leave if they want to leave, but we've got a lot of good people that are committed and working, both single parents, husbands, wives, different broad sections. So I'm thinking in terms of staff. Thirdly, I'm thinking in terms of the more normal we live, the more normal we become. And also, most members are going to work hard. I mean, most people that get in this business, I mean, and Dave makes a very good point. He 5:30. I mean, you got to balance out. I can't get what I want, or Romer can't get what she wants, or Dave is right. You got to bounce it out. I think we can do a better job. I worried, you know, during the floor, Dave and I shared a very close friendship with Bill Emerson. God bless Bill. Bill was dying of cancer and never missed a vote and stayed there. I worried about some of those nights he would just be there, and we were doing, frankly, nothing almost. I mean, people were calling things that shouldn't have been called. Lastly, I'm going to write to the Speaker and tell him that this is going to be my last term in this job. I think the next person who should be chairman of the Family-Friendly Caucus ought to be a member like Enid or a member somebody who has their family back in the district. I thank the good Lord that I go home to my house a half an hour from here. I'm home in my own bed, my own pillow, my own desk, my own kitchen table, and so I haven't had the problems. But I felt the burden. I've had members come up and tell me, about this, and I got this problem, and I really kind of feel for it. And I've tried to take it as if I wasn't representing my interests. In fact, some of the things that we worked out worked against my situation, and Romer got a little worked against his to help the new guys that had their family back. So the next year, I think we ought to have a person, I think the speaker ought to appoint a person who has their family back in the district, who comes here, and so they can take that perspective. It's a tough job, good people on both sides. We really can do a better job, and I think families their comfort level will be raised if they know there's an effort being made. And I appreciate you holding this hearing. It's a very important hearing, I think.
Thank you both very much. We appreciate your diligence and the very thoughtful remarks that you've made. Next, we'll hear from our colleague from the District of Columbia, Eleanor Holmes Norton. I was privileged to serve with Eleanor on the Joint Committee on the Organization of Congress, and this hearing today is to look at further reforms, and so we've been working at it. And I know that you want to talk about delegate voting in the Committee of the Whole again, Eleanor. We're happy to have you, and if you could summarize your statement, your entire prepared remarks will appear in the record.
I will do that, Mr. Chairman.
You might want to take the microphone, get it a little closer to you.
I will do that, Mr. Chairman. I will simply briefly summarize my testimony, and let me say first how much I appreciate the opportunity to make the case for a limited vote on the House floor in the Committee of the Whole for the District of Columbia. This is a very small gesture or action for this body, but to the 500,000 people I represent, it figures large. I'm asking for a limited right to vote that I originally secured in 1993, and I'm asking for that right for the district out of respect for their status as tax-paying residents of the United States. When the vote was withdrawn, I do not believe that the circumstances of the district were ever considered. They are special circumstances. They were withdrawn in a package of rules, and the district did not consider this to be aimed at the district as such, and all of the delegates were included. With all respect, the district is profoundly different from the four territories. The best way to understand that is to put yourself in the position of my constituents, or perhaps in my position. Suppose you represented people who were second per capita in federal income taxes. Suppose your budget, your own local budget of your own county or city, had to come to this body before any money could be spent and could be changed in any way by this body. Suppose your representative had to stand by and watch this body do whatever it wanted to do with respect to that budget, but had no vote whatsoever at any point on that budget or any other matter on the House floor. And suppose you represented people who had fought and died in every war in the United States from the Revolutionary War forward, and in the most recent war, Desert Storm, sent more troops than 47 of the states. If you put yourself in that context, you can see why even something perhaps rather small to you means very much to the people I represent. The vote was won fair and square. I submitted a legal memorandum. It was submitted then to outside counsel. The outside counsel said, look, it's up to you. There's no constitutional bar. There was a vote on the House floor, up and down. That vote gave to all the delegates without distinction among them the vote. There was a legal challenge. In that challenge, the House prevailed in both the district court and the Court of Appeals. Court said it's constitutionally permissible. What we need is only your permission. It is a very short step from what the delegates have historically always had. The delegates have all the privileges of House members, including the vote in committee, and have had that traditionally. Empowering the delegates is an interesting thing that the founders did from the beginning, because the territories were people like them. We were one people, except some people had already made statehood and some had not. So the delegates essentially often served in important posts in the House. Because of the American tradition, frankly, of a distaste for different ranks of citizenship. Let me indicate just how limited the right I seek is. It's directly analogous to the committee vote, the vote I have in my committee, Transportation and Infrastructure, to name one of them. Interestingly, there's no revote there. Because, of course, it just goes to the Committee of the Whole. Because this vote is not final, just as the vote in the Committee of the Whole is not final. The Committee of the Whole was created by the first Congress to get out from under the procedures that the full House requires, knowing full well that nothing is final until the full House votes on it. The courts found that Article 1, Section 5, Clause 2 says that each House can decide its own rules, so you can do it or not do it, and I'm asking you to do it. The vote is insulated and limited and confined to the Committee of the Whole. For example, if by some chance, it would be rare, but occasionally there would be votes where the votes of the delegates sent something to the House. In that case, there would be a revote in order to avoid any constitutional question of whether delegates, in fact, were affecting directly the right to vote in the House itself. Finally, let me indicate that I am requesting the right to vote under the unique circumstances affecting my constituents only. They are the only Americans who pay federal income taxes, $1.6 billion every year, and don't have a representative in a voting representative in the national legislatures. Let me remind you that the principle that created this republic, no taxation without representation, literally has applied throughout to every other territory except the district, because the four territories who have the same representation as the district pay no federal income taxes, and yet they indeed are represented here by delegates as the district is. Let me say also that the four territories have complete self-government. We are the only Americans who do not enjoy democratic self-government. And we are the only Americans where Congress has taken unto itself to appropriate locally raised revenues. That is perhaps the strangest of the powers this Congress has taken when you consider how much we value people having a say over their own lives and certainly their own money. Wherever you may be on delegate voting in general, Mr. Chairman, a limited vote for the tax-paying residents of the district in particular speaks to the equities that are very deep in the heart of the American Constitution and in the principles by which we live. And I ask you to allow that limited vote in the Committee of the Whole for the people I represent. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Eleanor. Appreciate your coming before us. The one thing that does come to mind is the last time we did have this procedure, all of the delegates did have it, and I wondered if you have discussed this at all with the other delegates and what their response.
I certainly have. I thought it was important always to be up front with the other delegates. From the beginning, what I think moved the House to grant the right to vote in the first place was a legal memorandum I submitted which described the particular circumstance of the district, which are unique. At the same time, we noted that there had never been differential treatment among delegates, and we thought it was constitutional for them to allow a limited right to vote to the other delegates because, like the district, they couldn't affect the full House. But from the very beginning, I said to the other delegates, gentlemen, you have a privilege that most Americans would exchange for members of the House. You said to most Americans, hey, would you rather have a member of the House or no taxes? I don't think anybody here would want to put that proposition to their own constituents. So I said, in as much as there is that profound difference between Inasmuch as there's that profound difference between you and me, I will not argue that you do not have the right to vote, but I have to tell you that the difference is so profound and so deep that that is the basis on which I will make my case. And I did it from the beginning. Last year, I said to them again that the taxpaying status of the district looms large here. I don't oppose your vote, but I have an obligation to the people I represent, and I certainly will not say to the world there's no difference between you and me. So we've been absolutely straight. Mm-hmm. To which they do not say, "Hey, Eleanor, we want to give up the taxpaying, non-taxpaying status we have in order to be in the position you are in." Mm-hmm. What their only retort is, "Well, remember, Eleanor, we do pay taxes, but we pay them to our own commonwealth or our mm-hmm. own territory." And again, that is a profound difference, and mm-hmm. one which is in keeping with representation, mm-hmm. no representation in this body without taxation.
Thank you. Mr. Solomon?
Well, first, Mr. Chairman, let me say to Eleanor Holmes Norton, she is one of the most respected members of this body, and I particularly admire her because of her tenacity and her due diligence in representing the people of the D.C. district, and we all admire you for it, Eleanor. I do have some differences with the issue of the delegates being able to cast votes on the floor of Congress. As you know, I was a part of the lawsuit to try to clarify this issue. So let me just, first of all, preface my remarks by saying that there is considerable merit to the argument you make as far as the people of the D.C. district in comparison to the other delegates. And certainly we need to take that into consideration, and at some point down the road, this has to be, I think, settled one way or the other, and perhaps settled in the courts. As the gentlelady knows, when the provision was originally proposed, the rule change to allow delegate voting on the floor of Congress, it was to give you a vote on the floor. And because of the pending lawsuit by those of us that had brought it, the rule was changed, and so that the final result was that you would be able to vote in the Committee of the Whole, but not in the full Committee of the House. And consequently, I don't have the file here today, but as I recall, the court said that, in effect, because the vote, if the vote counts, it doesn't count, and therefore there would be a re-vote in the Committee of the House. That's very confusing to those people that might be watching this committee, but in effect, the problem then arose with the old question of perhaps log rolling, and we know we have that in the Congress, and that's where you know, one member will say, "You vote for my bill, I'll vote for yours," or "You vote for my amendment, I'll vote for yours." We saw that during the extensive debate on the agricultural bill this past year, and so that there is a question of whether the vote counts or doesn't count, and but. Having said all that, I would continue to oppose delegate voting in the full House, but I think there's merit to the D.C. situation, which you so eloquently present to us, and I think we as a committee can look at that, and I think the entire leadership in both sides of the aisle ought to take a look at it, and I for one would be doing that, and will take your advice and consent into consideration.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bielans.
Could I respond? First, I want to thank Mr. Solomon for his kind and generous remarks. The question of the court suit, the matter was settled in court, but it came up after the issues you described were settled, and I know how that can be confusing as well. In writing the memorandum, I was sensitive to this distinction between the Committee of the Whole and the House. So from the beginning, while I hadn't figured out the re-vote notion, I did indicate that the vote must be insulated from going to the full House. And that was all done before the matter was voted on in the House. So it was voted on in the House, the insulation had taken place, what was put in place had been put in place before the vote occurred. Then it was that final matter that was put to the courts.
Right.
The court looked, I think, at the insulation that you described, and I think that helped to save the vote because they could see that this notion of log rolling you're speaking of. The reason that can't occur here, and you're right when you say
we're
that
all
it's confusing
guilty of it.
About if it's vote if it counts or doesn't count. Well, if it doesn't count, of course, and we all vote to do it, because really there's no harm done. But what the reason we don't have to worry about log rolling here is that if the delegate decides it, then there's got to be a re-vote with the delegate out of it. So the delegate can't matter if, in fact, the delegate is the deciding vote. Otherwise, what you're doing is you're saying to Eleanor Holmes Norton, hey, your constituents can look up there just like mine and hold you accountable to see how you voted. About all it means is that they can see how I vote. There was a joke that one member said to me about this is who's now in the minority, had accustomed himself to being in the majority when he saw himself coming to the floor constantly and voting and seeing that you always outvoted him. He said, hey, Eleanor, my vote doesn't count either. in a real sense, the votes of the minority don't count, but if you try to take it from Mr. Bielenson, because most of the time it doesn't matter, I think you'd hear from him. So I don't think the log rolling can take place. And finally, let me say to you, what was most gratifying after the vote was that a number of Republicans came up to me and said, Eleanor, if it had only been the district, bearing in mind your taxpaying status, I would have wanted to vote with you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. I wish only to say that I personally found Ms. Norton's testimony absolutely compelling. I don't know the answer to it, if I may say so. I think she's found the most effective way of putting the question to us. I mean, I cannot imagine being in her position where you're representing a half million or more tax-paying citizens and are unable to vote on these matters, especially so since the Congress interests itself in the internal matters of the district a great deal more than it does in the internal matters of the people in the areas that whom we represent. And on top of that, of course, she's also asking something which I think is really politically possible. We're not talking about giving five votes, we're talking about giving one. And I take it, I don't know this for a fact, but I assume our Republican friends in the past were a little concerned about giving delegates votes because usually four of them, sometimes five of them, were Democrats, and you're giving a whole bunch of additional Democratic votes. In this case, you're giving just one additional vote, and I do hope that next year whoever is in charge will take her pleas seriously and look at the particular situation, the peculiar situation, if I may, of the District of Columbia, and allow our good friend here, assuming she's reelected, as we hope and believe she will be, the chance to properly represent and be accountable to her constituents as we are to ours.
Ms. Green?
I have no comments or questions. Thank you.
I apologize for not being here for your testimony. I will read it. If Mr. Bielenson says it was compelling. I will be very interested to read it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ellen. Appreciate your being here.
Our next witness is the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Barton, who is going to talk about his proposal of drug testing for members and staff. Joe, we're happy to have you, and you're welcome to summarize your statement. The entire prepared remarks will appear in the record.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thought I'd read it verbatim very slowly, but since you asked me to summarize it, I will summarize. Let me say that it's interesting to come before this committee. It's the smallest standing committee of the House, and it's the only committee that I know of that has two chairmen, because it says Mr. Dreyer chairman and Mr. Solomon chairman. So even though it's small, it's so busy that it has to have two chairmen. No, I appreciate being here. I want to talk about drug testing for members, but before I do that, I want to skip back to Mr. Wolf's testimony. Mr. Romer's testimony. I am one of the members that lives in my district. I've got over 2 million frequent flyer miles. And we tried what Mr. Bielenson recommended, and it just didn't work for my family. They didn't like living in Washington. They didn't like not being in Texas. So I'm not going to get into all the possibilities, but two things that have been done in this Congress that I think make it more family friendly if your family is here
is, A, during the day, when possible, roll as many votes as possible so that you do get out a little bit earlier because you're not going back and forth. That's, y'all have done an excellent job on that. And on occasion, you've scheduled some family time, do debate from 5 to 8, and you let members go home and have supper with their family. And if you'll continue those two things, if your family is here, you can see them in the evening, you can have supper with them, and by rolling as many votes as possible, you probably save 2 hours a day so that you get out sooner. So those two, you've already done it in this Congress, and if you just reinforce that in the rules. Let me now talk about drug testing for members of Congress. Back in either 1989 or 1990, I did a town meeting in Corsicana, Texas, which at that time was in my district. During the course of the town meeting, a Continental Airline pilot stood up said that it was a requirement that he be tested, submit to a mandatory urinalysis test for illegal substances because he was a pilot. And he wanted to know if I was drug tested as a member of Congress. I said, no, there's no requirement that that I submit to mandatory drug testing. And he said, well, you have voted to require that I have to take this test. I think you ought to practice what you preach. And everybody in the town meeting applauded and thought that they had put me on the spot. And I said, well, I don't want to speak for all members of Congress, but I certainly am not unwilling to be tested. And I'll start a drug testing program for myself, and I'll try to get it done for the Congress. So I came back and in either 90 or 91 offered a bill that would have required mandatory testing for all members of Congress. I got a vote out on the House floor. It was very difficult, but I finally managed a vote and it passed. It was stripped in the conference with the Senate. In the meantime, I started a drug testing program for myself and my staff. I've done that ever since. I've done it for 5 years. I'm tested 3 or 4 times a year on a random basis. Smith Kline, a very respected laboratory, does the testing. It's unannounced. We test myself. Anytime anybody is tested, I'm tested, and then other members of my staff are tested on a random basis, normally one in the district offices and one here in Washington. Cost me between $500 and $1,000 a year. I have to pay for it personally, because it's not a voucherable expense right now. But it's been an excellent program. The test results go to a medical review officer to make sure that there's no problem. And then the test results come to me as the employer. And we have had occasions when members of the staff, there were some questions about the test and they had to be retested. It's all done confidentiality on a confidential basis. Bottom line is, I think I'm the only member that has instituted a drug testing program in the member's office, and I've had no problems with it from any standpoint, from confidentiality, from false positives, from it actually works. And so the bill that I have reintroduced in this Congress, and that I'd still like to get a vote on in this Congress, says that all members would be tested. Every member, all 435 members, would be tested on a random basis. You'd test 10% at random each month. Those results would be reported to a medical review officer that the House chooses, and would be reported to the Ethics Committee. And once each session of Congress in the even-numbered year, in October, the results would be made public. It's possible a member could go the entire Congress and never be subjected to a drug test. It's also possible a member could be tested 24 times, could be in the 10% that it picks at random each month. But if we're going to vote, as we have in past Congresses, to require mandatory drug testing for certain sectors of the private sector, if we're going to make an issue when the executive branch chooses to exempt some of its employees in sensitive positions from drug testing, which we've done in this Congress with the Clinton administration, I think it is absolutely logical, and I think it's a very practical extension of our living by the rules that we want the rest of the country to live by, to subject members of Congress to drug testing. Now, in the past, there's been a lot of hilarity and mockery made of the fact that the test has been a urinalysis test. Well, we actually have some new testing procedures for hair testing. That's actually a better test. It goes back approximately 9 months. You just clip a lock of the hair. It's the cost of that test has come down tremendously. So that if you've got an objection because of the method of testing, i.e., you object to a urinalysis sample, then we can do the hair testing. Next week on September the 18th, I'm going to do a voluntary testing demonstration program over in the Rayburn Nurse's Office. Members can choose to come and have some of their hair clipped, or they can subject to a urinalysis sample, or both, just to show that it's doable and it's practical, and it makes a lot of sense. And so I would hope, if we can't get Chairman Solomon's bill or my bill up on the floor for this Congress, that we certainly put it in the rules package to allow the testing, and also allow members that choose to test to voucher it, and that in any event, every member of Congress be subject on a random basis. I can think of no other thing that would more state and make the case to the American people that we are absolutely determined to be responsible, to fight the war on drugs, and to live by the same rules that today more and more Americans have to live by, in this case, the drug testing in the workplace.
Thank you very much, Joe. I know that there's been some editorial criticism. I think I saw an editorial in the roll call the last few days, and there have been some critics of this, and I wondered how you've responded to some of the criticism that's come forward.
Well, I've, in past Congresses, I had one particular member say I should take an IQ test, that it was such a silly idea, and in that particular case, I visited that member in his office, man to man, if it's politically correct to say that, and we reached a mutual understanding. There is no, the substantive argument against it is that it's somehow an invasion of privacy. I think that argument is overcome by the simple fact that we vote as congressmen to require it in many cases. The executive branch requires it in what they define as sensitive positions. And in any event, as public servants who volunteer to run for office, we acknowledge that our right to privacy is not the same as it is if we were not members of the House of Representatives. So that's the only really substantive argument against it. The arguments that it's, in the past, they've made arguments that it's not, the tests are not reliable. Well, the tests are 99.99% reliable today, and in any event, you send the test results to a medical review officer who looks for exceptional cases to see if there's some sort of a problem that needs to be retested. So the reliability argument doesn't hold. So it really comes down to an integrity issue. Are you really willing to submit yourself to the same workplace rules that you say, in many cases, the American public has to submit to? And as a public servant, who almost all of us vote to fight the war on drugs, to make it real, are we willing to set a personal example? And I have done it. Again, this is not something that I'm talking about in a theoretical sense. Since 1991, I have had mandatory drug testing for myself in my congressional office every year, and I've also done it for my own staff, which I don't require in my bill that it be done at the staff level. So I've practiced what I preached. I've paid for it out of my own pocket. I've had to be tested on days I was doing town meetings in the district. I've had to be tested on days that I was booked, as we all are up here, too deep for 10 hours a day. It is a little inconvenient on heavily scheduled days, but again, it's something I think that we absolutely need to do if we want to restore more credibility to this institution. And if we get it in the rules package, or if we get it on a floor vote, it will pass. Not only will it pass, it will pass probably close to unanimously. Drug use is up in the country. Drug use among teenagers has doubled in the last 4 years. The types of drugs that are being used are becoming more potent. Mr. Goss, I'm a former FBI agent, probably knows more about this than I do, but when you can buy heroin that's 70% pure on the streets of New York, when you can buy cocaine that's 60% pure in Dallas, Texas, you've got a drug problem. And we need to do something about it, and one thing we need to do is to set a positive example by what we do here in the Congress of the United States.
I'm flattered to be thought to have been a former FBI agent. Actually, it was the CIA, but they are very much heavily...
Some A.
They're right. Heavily involved, as you know, and need to be. We all need to be in the war on drugs. I think that everything you said makes tremendous sense. I tend to believe that members of Congress should be role models. That's one of the ways you build institutional credibility, and being a member of Congress is something that parents want their children to grow up to be. Seems to me to be a worthwhile objective. And I feel very strongly that this is a great idea. I think you should extend the idea to random testing to all people in the workplace, and I don't know whether that is in your intent or not. In addition to members, I do feel that the full workplace question should be raised.
Well, I'm not opposed to that, Porter. I'm doing it for the members of the House because I'm a member of the House, but I'm not opposed to extending it.
I think there are two separate objectives, and again, it's your idea, and I congratulate you for bringing it forward. I think that the members of the House idea is extremely important because of the role model aspect and all the rest of the message sent, but I also think it should be carried to the workplace because we have a good deal of public trust that we carry here, and a lot of the materials we talk to are sensitive, actually, and would be harmful if not handled properly, and as we see, regrettably, from time to time when they are not handled properly. The point on the workplace, many of us have tried different ways. My office system doesn't work the same as yours does, but I have an honor system policy, which I participate in, which I think works, and if there is evidence that there is a problem, I think we have a way to deal with that, and a full expectation among my employees. And I think that's worked well, but I think your additional program would work so much better. The only thing I say, half in jest, half seriously, is that if we are going to do workplace, we should make everybody subject to it, and that would include all people who use the Capitol and the Capitol facilities, they use the workplace area, that would include the media.
Yeah, well, I'm not opposed to that. It's just to try to minimize the cost. If you do it for 435 members, that's 43 a month, that you can get various prices for the cost of the test, but it's $10 to $30.
Well, my thinning hair is getting more and more precious per strand, but I would be willing to give up a strand every so often, and I think other people would, and maybe if we do volume, we can get a cheaper price.
Drug testing does work. When the military instituted drug testing in the mid-'80s, reportedly, the military had one of the worst illegal drug use problems of any subgroup of our culture. Today, they are the most drug-free of any subgroup because it was mandatory. There was no exceptions. It was zero tolerance. The Joint Chiefs reinforced it, and it worked. It worked tremendously well. It will work here. I don't stipulate that there is an illegal drug use problem among members of Congress or even among the staff, if you want to extend it beyond that. But to the extent there is, if you have drug testing, you will identify it, and then you can take the corrective steps necessary to correct the problem.
I would only add briefly, Mr. Chairman, that I recently been watching reports by, I think, Mr. Green, who's a former NFL player, about the lack of success of the NFL to have the same kind of success that the military has had. And one of the reasons that he cited in a TV interview, I guess probably preparing us for his new book on this subject, was to talk about the degrees to which people will go to rule beat the drug testing, so that that provision has to be provided for, and I know you know about that well. Even to the point of having urine injected into your bladder, clean urine, so that you have the clean urine to put into the test, which was...
Well, I don't know how you would beat the hair test if you're... If
I would rather give you a piece of my hair than go through all that, I'll tell you flat out.
You could, I guess theoretically we could require members to go on the floor of the House and have their hair clipped and have it put in a gas spectrometer right there on the floor. I mean, if you're worried about people trying to beat the test, you can, you know, with a hair test, you can make that impossible to beat.
Good, because I think we do need a system that is relatively foolproof so there are no unintended victim, innocent yeah. victims here.
Joe, you know I want to commend you for being here because you and I have worked on this this issue for many, many, many years now, and I certainly will be joining you next week for both a hair clipping and a urinalysis test as well. We've I've participated with you right along. Let me just at the offset say that the news media had an error saying that that Jerry Solomon personally did not have a random drug testing program in his office, and I just want to counter that. I've had one since the day I arrived in this Congress, and basically it says that anyone who comes to work for the Rules Committee or comes to work on my personal staff is as a condition of employment, and this gets into the privacy business, but as a condition of employment, they will submit to random drug tests.
I have that, the same statement.
And that means there's no question about it. It means if you're hired to sweep the floor or if you're hired to run a computer, in other words, if you don't run it as you're supposed to, then you've violated your condition of employment. And the same holds true with random drug testing. Let me just say that your bill in particular is not before our committee. As you know, it goes before government oversight, and so that we don't have the jurisdiction to act on it. I do have, as you know, legislation pending before the Congress that would require random drug testing of members of Congress and personnel. That means officers and employees of the United States Congress. Again, as you have stated, I do not believe that there is a serious problem either among members or among employees of the Congress. No doubt there are people that use drugs, but I don't think it is significant. But that's not the point. The point is that we ought to be setting the example. You brought out very vividly back in the early 80s when Ronald Reagan was president. At my urging and others, we did implement a program of random drug testing of all military personnel. At that time, and this is back in 1981 and 82, there was as much as 25% usage of drugs among our military, and that was a terrible situation. Just think what would happen if they had to go into combat risking other people's lives and you might be under the influence of drugs. That was terrible. So President Reagan did, by executive order, implement random drug testing. And within 4 years, it dropped from 25% down to 4%, which is very, very, very small. If we could do that nationwide, if we could do it in the federal government, of all employees, if we could do it in the state governments and the counties and the towns and the cities and villages, everywhere in the public sector, if we could drop that use from whatever it is down to less than 4%, if we could then do it in the private sector as General Electric Company, as IBM, major Fortune 500 companies are doing, if everybody would do it, just think what would happen. You would actually destroy the value of these terrible life-taking drugs. That's why we need to set the example here.
Well, it's Mr. Chairman.
Before you go any further, let me just finish. Here's an article that was in USA Today, date rape drugs being used today. You mentioned that drug use has doubled in recent years. It is more pathetic than that. Among 12 and 13-year-olds, the use of illegal drugs has increased over 100% in the last 4 years, 12 and 13-year-olds. Among 14 and 15-year-olds, it's gone up 200%. And just think what is happening now as we go on through. That's what's happening. In according to the RAND studies, 75% of all the illegal drug use in America today is used by people of the middle class, upper middle class, people that live in suburban areas, not in the hardcore areas. 75% of those drugs, that means that people are driving into the ghettos, coming in here, buying those drugs, propping up the price. It also means that 75% of all of the violent crime against women and children today, 75% is drug-related. That's how serious this problem is getting to be nationwide. So I can just assure you that when we open up the 105th Congress, if I'm still chairman of the committee and you gentlemen here all support it too, we will have a rule change that is going to require random drug testing of every member of Congress and all personnel, officers and directors and employees of this Congress. We're going to help set that example, and we're going to do something about this terrible drug use in America. This is one small way that you and I can do it. So having said all that, let me now yield back to you and commend you for it.
Mr. Chairman, thank you on a personal level for your leadership. You were fighting this fight before I got to the Congress, and you've stood tall when we were in the minority, and you're continuing to practice what you preach now that you're in the majority, and that's not always the case. So I want to thank you for that. The only point I was going to make is that our earlier effort 4 or 5 years ago, there was one of the sub-arguments was that this wasn't necessary or that it wasn't being done on a routine basis generally in the general public. That's no longer the case. Almost, as you've pointed out, almost every major corporation has some sort of testing option, and in as we have done in prior Congresses, we now require it for many occupations where public health, public safety is at risk, and in the construction industry, at least in Texas, drug testing is required before you even go to work now. Almost every construction company in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, as a condition of employment, you've got to submit to a drug test to prove that you're drug-free before you even get the job because of the danger to the other workers in the construction project. So since it's so generally accepted now and it's been litigated in the courts, it's beyond me why we don't do it just routinely in the Congress. And I'll certainly, if I'm in this Congress the next session, I'll support your rule change and every other effort that you make to fight the war on drugs.
Thank you very much, Joe.
Thank you. I'll simply say I think we all know now from this administration's abysmal record on the war on drugs and the concomitant steep rise in use by young children and teenagers of drugs that public leadership on this issue matters. And so I salute what you're doing. I support what you're doing. I think that regardless of whether you think there's really a problem among members is not the point. The point is demonstrating our leadership to the public that we're willing to live by the rules we're imposing on others.
I agree. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Joe.
Thank you, David.
We appreciate it. Let me just say that, do you want to be recognized, Mr. Chairman?
When you're done, I have an announcement.
Okay. Let me just say that this does close the series of four hearings that the Joint Committee has held. And I would like to congratulate Ms. Green, who unfortunately will not be here, chose not to run for election, will not be part of the 105th Congress, but to say that she'll be sorely missed, and we appreciate very much her active participation in this series of hearings looking at a wide range of changes that we'll be making in the 105th Congress, and we'll look forward to those proposals because the issue of reform is one that we plan to continue, and I want to thank my colleagues, Mr. Goss and Mr. Solomon, who have worked with us long and hard on it. With that, I'd like to recognize Mr. Solomon.
Chairman, let me commend you and Chairman Goss for carrying out these hearings. They will be invaluable, especially since there evidently will be new reorganization meetings right after the elections, and therefore it is incumbent on all of us to get our recommendations in so that we can have those recommendations prepared for the two caucuses of the Democrat and Republican Party. Having said that, let me remind the Democrat staff as well as our own staff that there will be a rules hearing on Tuesday at 1 o'clock on the Puerto Rico issue, and there will likely be a rules meeting at 4 o'clock on banking legislation, and we will make that announcement later on this afternoon as to the precise times. And thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Our congressional directory helps you follow proceedings in the House and Senate. It has members' biographies and committee assignments, and information about C-SPAN's programs. The directory costs $9.95.